Now, how can fornication be sex before marriage?
And that's coming out of Yahusha's mouth.
Twice.
How can fornication be sex before marriage? It's not. In fact, in the Hebrew Bible, there is no sin of sex before marriage. It is not, even in the, when you study the rabbinical laws, they shy away from it. They don't want you to have sex before marriage, but it is not a sin. You can't find that in the scriptures where that's a sin. That was made up, man.
Can I ask you something?
Sure.
First of all, thank you for inviting me. Good to hear you guys. If the ways in the Bible to get married, the three ways that we know in the Old Testament to get married is, if one of them is having relations, as you mentioned last time in one of the previous classes, lectures that you're talking about, when Yeshua, in the quote unquote Virgin Mary, that whole situation, if having relations considered married, would it be that then there would be no such thing as premarital sex because you're married once you have that relation?
That's right.
Correct.
That's right. Because once a man, read it, it's in Shemot. So when you read it, it says if he goes and if a man, someone get that. Get Shemot 22:16. It says a man entice a woman that is not betrothed. That means she's engaged to be married. When a man and a woman has been betrothed, that means they've already made a promise to get married. The actual second part of the marriage doesn't take place until they've actually had the ceremony. But to betrothed to a woman means that you really already married her, because that's a promise that they're not supposed to make. I mean, to break. That's a promise that they're not supposed to break. Once they are betrothed, the customary ceremony is that man and the woman, they drink from the same cup of wine, which represents their first kiss of exchanging efforts. And so from that point, if the man doesn't have a house for her to move in, there was generally a waiting period where he would go back to his father's home, save up enough money, because the law states that once a man gets married, he's not supposed to go to war or go to work for a whole year. So he's supposed to have enough to make this up. That's what the law says.
You cut off when you said the man's supposed to have enough.
Yeah, I'm just saying what the law says, man. I said after a man betroths a woman, he would typically go back to his father's house until he saves up enough to be able to move into his own home with his wife.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Someone get it in the law. It's in the law. Devarim 24.
I was looking for Shemot. Did you say Shemot also?
Oh, no. Yeah, I thought one of them was getting that. Someone get that. We pulled that, man.
Exodus 22.
22 Shemot or
Exodus chapter 22, verse 16. And if a man entice a maid that is not betrothed and lie with her, he shall surely endow her to be his wife.
There you go.
See that? So what does that mean, J.D.? That means he hadn't had sex with her. If the woman wasn't betrothed to any other man, she wasn't promised to any other man, then if he has sex with that woman, it says he shall endow her to be his wife. That's the second part of the marriage, which is the ceremony.
Right. And now you bring up Devarim, which is Deuteronomy, which just talks about when they go to war, right? I think that's what you're referring to. Right?
Yeah. Devarim 24, verse 5.
Okay. I can... I'm in Devarim right now. I'm going to pull up chapter 24.
Devarim, Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 5. Mm-hmm. When a man hath taken a new wife, he shall not go out to war, neither shall he be charged with any business, but he shall be free at home 1 year and shall cheer up his wife, which he hath taken.
See that?
Yep.
That was that's in the law.
Yep. That's part of my chapter of, you know, when I was my bar mitzvah, I guess you would say. You know, that was the same chapter or parasha or verse of my, you know, of when I was born that same year.
Yes.
At the same time. Yeah. It talks about the laws are very, you know, they're very in depth for that time. You know, they were talking about war. They're talking about, you know, just some, you know, if you go out to war, you know, and against your enemies, you know, and what you're supposed to do with the beautiful, you see a beautiful woman, you desire her, you know, and you take her for your wife, but you can't leave her there. You can't just have a relationship right. with her and then leave, you know, you got to take her with you.
Yep. Yep. And I mean, this is even carried over to the Besorah. We could find that in the Besorah. We could find it in the book of Lukos 14 and 20. The man say, I can't go to war because I just got married. Mm-hmm. Someone get that real quick.
Con, the book of Luke, chapter 14, verse 20. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come.
And where did he get that from? He got it from the law. He got it from the law.
If you break the law back then... That's it.
They'd be referring back to the law, man.
Yeah,
read in the Besorah, guess what? You could find it. You either find it in the Torah, you might find it in the prophets, or you'll find it in the writings. It comes from one of those. It's nothing new. One of those three schools.
You know, you talked about zona or whore, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that even you're talking about. I mean, you're talking about just the idea of that an actual whore or prostitute. You know,
but it could also be a spiritual whore. It could also be a spiritual whore that go and worship another god. I don't like using that word god. Another Allah.
Power.
Elohim.
Another faith, maybe?
No, like another creator, I'll say that. When they go and worship false gods, when they go and worship idols, that's a form of fornication.
Yeah. But what is an idol? Because there's so many ideas of an idol, right? I mean, money's an
golden
idol.
Golden calf.
Yeah, golden calf.
Zeus, the queen of heaven, Ishtar.
Yeah. But even like Ra. Money, even like physical, movie stars, television, you know, cars.
Yeah. A priest. Like the Pope. The Pope is an idol.
Come on.
They kiss his ring.
So how does Yeshua fit in this in the whole realm then? If it's the Mashiach, how does that fit in the... I know
I saw that question coming from a mile away.
Did you?
Yeah, you've asked this already. You've Come asked on. This already. You're just asking it in a different way. You've asked. You know, how
that man, it's a good question, man. The kind of questions that he asks keeps you short on your sword, man. True, you understand what I'm saying?
That's true, that's true.
He always asks really good questions, man.
I mean, just to understand, you know.
My man JT, man. JT's a good dude, man.
Appreciate it. Thank you. I think y'all
can't hate on that.
So someone want to answer that? How does HaMashiach come in? Because remember, I guess you have to look at JD like a he only reads the Tanakh. Mm. You guys know what the acronym Tanakh represents?
The writings.
No, it's more than just the writings. It's an acronym.
Old Testament.
Well, the Torah, right, is the first Torah.
Yeah.
And then? Right, the prophets, the Nevi'im.
Yep.
And Ketuvim, which is the scripture, or the writings. Ketuv in Hebrew is to write. Yichtov is to write. Ketuv is the writing. Ketuvim are the writings. Yeah. When you talked about you know, Zona, Zion is a male member, in a package, you know, the man's, you know, Zion. Zona is a, you know, a whore, prostitute. Lech Tizda'en, go to hell, go F yourself. It's all that kind of, it all has that same kind of root or shoresh, you know, that they usually, a lot of the words are based on these three letters, which is called the shoresh or the root word. When we talk about the individual words and how they kind of play off each other, the prepositions and and all the possessions of each individual word. It's interesting. It's interesting language, and I think that language, you know, is something that kind of builds on many other languages. I see it like that. I don't know so many other languages, but that's how I see how I can, you know, how
this. All right, let's go on to some prophecies, so we can help JD out with the coming of Messiah.
There's going to be another one, right? There's going to be one more coming too, right? There's a second one coming. This is just the first.
Now, so let me say this: there's a lot of people. They don't read the Besorah, but and they denounce HaMashiach, Yahusha, because, you know, they only even a lot of people that read, I guess, the Bibles, you know, they say and some people only read what they refer to as the New Testament. So when you look it up, the word testament just simply means covenant, right? So the word testament is really a derivation of the Latin word testamentum, well, which was actually used in Jerome's Vulgate to translate the Hebrew word brother covenant. So remember that the Roman Vulgate was really, it's Latin primarily, right? So the Greek, they have an equivalent word for testament. But so you'll find a lot of Christians that will say, well, let's just read the New Testament. The Old Testament was done away with, and that's a mistake. So, but then you have a lot of Old Testament, I'll just use the phrases that they use, that says, well, HaMashiach is not mentioned in the Old Testament, right? Where, like JD just asked, where does he come in? So let's see if we could find where he's bared witness to in the Tanakh. Let's go to Yeshaya
7:14.
9. And okay. Can you guys not hear me, man?
Salaki, I thought it was muted. Go ahead.
Where does 7:14 come from? We're going to Yeshaya 9:8.
Come. The book of Yeshaya, Isaiah chapter 9:8. Yahuwah sent a word into Jacob, and it had lighted upon Israel.
So the scriptures say Yahuwah sent the word to Yahuwah and have lighted upon Israel. Well, So the Heavenly Father sent this word to the children of Israel, to the nation of Ishmael. What was that word? Let's go to verse 6. This is the word. Watch this. Verse 6.
Verse 6. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty Allah, Power, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Verse 7.
This right here, JD, is prophetic. This is prophetic. This son is born to save the nation of Israel. What? This son is Yahushua HaMashiach. He's going to establish a new government for the nation of Israel, and he's going to destroy the current government, according to prophecy. Well, so a lot of people don't believe that. Read Yeshaya 9, verse 7.
The book of Yeshaya, chapter 9, verse 7. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end upon the throne of David.
Okay, so this is prophetic, JD. It's saying, so when this government is established, there's not going to be any end to this government. A lot of Old Testament Israelites, or that's Torah center, they're trying to say this is David. This is not talking about David, because David rule came to an end. But it says his shall have no end.